Periscope, what's up? It is Tuesday morning. God bless you. Greg Howes here. Welcome to Leaderscope. Good to have you on with me this morning. God bless you so much. I hope things are well where you are. God bless you. God bless you. Let's get the coffee going. Good morning in the ATL. Atlanta is here. Good morning. High Energy Tuesday. Let's go. Caffeinated coffee. Come on. Get the real deal. Crusaders Church is in the house. Good morning, good morning, good morning. New York City, NYC, good morning. Ohio is here. Hobart, Indiana is here. All right, Michigan. You're on your third cup of coffee already? Wow. Dunkin' Donuts is okay, okay. Chicago Heights, Pittsburgh, Washington State. The West Coast is here. French Lick, Indiana, Virginia. Hey, Charlotte, North Carolina. Good morning. Merrillville, Indiana is in the house. Tulsa, Oklahoma. You guys surviving all the tornadoes down there? Y'all right? Good morning, good morning, good morning. High energy, come on. Your third and last son graduated from college. Well, congratulations. Jacksonville, Florida. Good morning, good morning. Schererville, Indiana is in the house. Good morning. Thank you for the hearts. Every time you tap the screen, you release a heart. So just keep tap, tap, tapping away. Thank you so much. We got some eggs, bacon, and toast, and OJ going on. All right, sounding good, sounding good. Live Oak, Florida, all right. UConn is here, Connecticut. Husky Nation, Broadview, Illinois. Good morning, good morning. Ridgeland, Mississippi. All right, God bless you, God bless you. God bless you. Thanks again for the hearts. You can go on, tap that little man in the corner. You can invite some friends and followers on the broadcast. Got your first cup of caffeine going. Hoffman Estates, Illinois. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning. God bless you guys. God bless you. Welcome, welcome, welcome. Mama Herring is here. Okay. Mama Herring's inviting some followers. Thank you so much, Mama Herring. God bless you guys. God bless you. Wow, it's great to have you on with me this morning. This is Teaching Tuesday here on Leaderscope, so we're going to do some teaching on the subject of dominion. So let's get ready to go. Dominion is the topic today. Are you ready? Are you ready? Are you ready? Let's go, let's go, let's go. All right. God bless you. God bless you. We have our eighth grade graduation at Cornerstone Christian School this evening, so that's going to be exciting for all of the eighth graders. Today I'm meeting with a friend of mine, a young leader that I met in the nation of Tanzania, and in that part of Africa, he is working with business leaders and political leaders, a young man and yet becoming a great man of influence in Eastern Africa. And he was in Washington, D.C. last week, and he flew in here to Chicago on Sunday evening and contacted me, so I'm going to be meeting up with him in just a little while after we finish the broadcast today. We're going to do some breakfast together and catch up on some things that are happening in Tanzania. So I'm excited about seeing my friend. It's going to be good to see him. It's been a couple of years, so I'm excited about that. God bless you. I'm excited you're with me today. Let's talk about dominion. Are you ready? Dominion, dominion. We get the dominion mandate from Genesis chapter 1 and verse 28. Genesis 1 and verse 28. That's where it all begins. God speaks to the man and the woman, and he said, then God blessed them. God blessed the man and the woman, and God said to them. So God spoke to both of them. He spoke to the man and the woman. Be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion. Have dominion. Have dominion. Have dominion. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. Another scripture that goes with that is Psalm 8 and verse 6. You have made man to have dominion, to have dominion, to have dominion over the works of your hands. And you have put all things under his feet. You put all things under his feet. I love Daniel chapter 4 and verse 3 as well. Daniel 4, 3 says, how great are his signs, how mighty his wonders. His kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and his dominion is from generation to generation. So dominion is a generational aspect. It's established in one generation, and then it is meant to be passed to the next generation. So that's important that my generation establish dominion in the earth so that we have something to pass on to the generation that's coming up behind us so that they don't have to reinvent the wheel, as it were. They can pick up right where we left off. But I love Genesis chapter 1 and verse 28. It gives us the pattern. It gives us the model that God has for mankind. He says, be fruitful. That means that we are designed to produce some things. So it is our responsibility to be productive. Let's produce something good in our lives. Then he says, multiply. And the word multiply means that we become larger. We become larger, or we have increased influence. Increased influence. So we're going to be fruitful, we're going to produce, and we're going to increase, we're going to multiply. Then he says, I want you to fill things up. Fill things up. That means that we will replenish what is lacking. Replenish what is lacking. And we will be those solutionists. We will be those solutionists that satisfy the cry of the earth. We're going to satisfy the cry of the earth. Remember in Romans chapter 8 and verse 19, it says, there is an earnest expectation rising out of creation. Creation is calling out for the manifestation of the sons of God. And so in filling things up, replenishing what is lacking, we are here to answer the cry of creation. We answer the cry of the earth. That is who we are. Then the next step in the process is we subdue. Subdue, that means that we overcome all resistance. We overcome resistance, we conquer, and we disarm our enemies. We disarm our enemies. And then the final step is dominion. Dominion is where we prevail. Dominion is where we walk on top of our enemies and every hindrance and every obstacle. We walk on top of it. We stand above it. That is dominion. We stand above it. We rule. We dominate. We act like the kings that God designed us to be. That is who we are when we move in dominion. Dominion means we have influence over all things. All things. John chapter 1 and verse 3, the Bible says, all things were made through him. Colossians 1:17 says, in him all things consist. All things. We have influence over all things when we're walking in dominion. So dominion is not the fight. It's not the battle to get to a certain place. Dominion is the resting place. Dominion is the position of prevailing after the battle is won. Subduing is winning the battle. Dominion is what happens after the battle. That's when we rule. That's when we prevail. So dominion is the practice of seeing and hearing and thinking and evaluating and making decisions and speaking and decreeing and behaving like a king. Like a king. You're going to see everything through the eyes of a king. You're going to hear every conversation through the ears of a king. You're going to think with the mind of a king, and you're going to speak with the mouth of a king. Remember in Ecclesiastes, the scripture says, where the word of a king is, there is power. That is me. That is you. We are people of dominion. Hallelujah. Psalm 72 and verse 8, scripture says, he shall have dominion also from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. And if you're wondering what that dominion is supposed to look like, you move down to verse 12, Psalm 72 and verse 12. The scripture goes on and says, he will deliver the needy when he cries, the poor also, and him who has no helper. This is what dominion looks like. He will spare the poor and the needy. He will save the souls of the needy. He will redeem their life from oppression and violence, and precious shall be their blood in his sight. That is what dominion is supposed to look like. Supporting the poor and the needy, helping the poor and the needy, answering the cry of the poor and the needy, rescuing the oppressed, breaking the powers of injustice, breaking the powers of violence in the land, the shedding of innocent blood. That's crucial here in Chicago, where I live. We have violence in the streets. We have young people being gunned down almost on a daily basis, at least a weekly basis. On the news, there will be a report about some other young person losing their lives to gang violence, to gun violence. And so as we practice subduing, as we overcome resistance, as we put these things under our feet, eventually we want to come to the place of dominion. And it doesn't seem like we're there yet, but we want to get there. So in order to have dominion, we must have illumination. We must have revelation. Illumination is needed. In the beginning, Genesis chapter 1 and verse 3, God said, "Let there be light." That was God's intent from the very beginning of things. Let there be light. Let there be illumination. Let there be revelation. Let it come upon us. John chapter 1 and verse 4, "In Christ was life." In him, in the Word, was life. L-I-F-E. And the life was the light, L-I-G-H-T, the light of men, the illumination of men, the revelation of men. Psalm 119, verse 130. The Bible says, "The entrance of your words give light." It gives light. When the Word of God enters, when it enters our lives, it's going to give us light. It's going to give us illumination. It will give us revelation. So when we're considering dominion and illumination, and then let's take it another step and consider discipleship. The traditional approach to discipleship has been giving an invitation to people. They come to an altar, they say a prayer, they accept Jesus as their personal Savior, they get involved with the activities of the local church. They may be baptized in water. They may be baptized in the Holy Spirit. And the whole aim is to get them prepared for eternity. Get ready to go to heaven. That becomes our aim in the traditional approach to discipleship. Get engaged with serving God in the local church. Make sure you're doing something in the local church. Traditional approach. Now, is there anything wrong with that? No, it's fine. It's good. That's a healthy thing. It's a good thing. But there is also a Jesus approach to discipleship. In Luke chapter 2 and verse 52, the scripture says, "Jesus increased in wisdom and stature and in favor with God and man." So the Jesus approach to discipleship is developing a broader impact on people. That means we're not just looking for them to say a simple prayer and invite Jesus into their hearts, but we're looking to transform, we're looking to develop, we're looking to empower, we're looking to activate, we're looking to release people into everything that they should be doing in the earth. And so there's going to be an increase in wisdom. That is our mental development. We want to see people learning, taking on knowledge, moving into innovative thinking, creativity, inventions, thinking, reasoning, problem solving, imagination, increase in wisdom. And then we want to see people increase in stature. That's physical development. That's including things like diet and exercise, reading, listening, observation, interaction with other people. That's the increase in stature. Then there's the increase in favor with God. Increase with favor, increase in favor with God. Spiritual development. Worship, prayer, reading, meditation, journaling, fasting, developing the anointing in your life, increasing in favor with God. And then there is increasing in favor with man, which is social development, relational development, where we move in the power of love and understanding and patience and gentleness and kindness and loyalty and peace and unity, cooperation and collaboration. That is where we want to go. We're moving toward dominion. And we are discipling people to be people of dominion. So it's more than just a matter of saying a little prayer and saying, "Jesus, come into my heart." It's a full, complete development of the whole man, spirit, soul, and body, preparing to be launched into the earth, to be a kingdom representative, to re-represent, to represent the King of all kings to an earth that is crying out for solutions and answers. We have the answer. Let's give it to the earth. Let's give it to creation. So, you've heard it said that to get something you've never had before, you will need to do something you've never done before. We've heard that over and over and over. Now let's add another step to that, another statement to that. To do something you've never done before, you're going to have to think in a way you've never thought before. When Israel came out of Egypt and they were wandering in the wilderness, God was feeding them with manna. They had a daily supply of manna in the wilderness for 40 years. A daily supply of manna, miraculous provision, but there was nothing extra. It was only manna for one day. Every day they had just enough for that one day. There was no increase experience. But when you get to Joshua chapter 5, when they're getting ready to go into the land of Canaan, the scripture says that the manna stopped. The manna stopped when Israel was entering the land of promise. Because at that point, they were going to be required to work, to plow, to cultivate, to plant, to wait patiently, and to bring about the harvest. They were going to eat the produce, and then they would store up seed for future crops. It was all about increase. It was about a harvest. It was about getting ahead and enjoying increase and experiencing abundance in their lives. It wasn't just going to be day by day by day any longer. It was then going to be a harvest of abundance that would set them up for the next 6 months, the next year, and even longer. That became the plan of God for their lives. It was the land of milk and honey. Milk and honey. In order to have milk, you've got to learn how to milk a cow. And you've got to be disciplined to do it every day. In order to have honey, you're going to have to deal with some bees. You're going to have to learn about the function of bees. And you're going to have to be watchful so you don't get stung. So there must be a new way of thinking as we move toward dominion. We're not going to think the way we have been thinking any longer. Proverbs chapter 23 and verse 7 says, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. If you think like a king, come on, train yourself to think like a king, and I'm telling you, you will become a king. Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 23, be renewed in the spirit of your mind so that you might move in to this realm of dominion. Y'all working with me today? Oh, I think it's good. I think it's good. I may continue this tomorrow. I've got a whole lot more on this topic, so we'll see how it goes. But I hope this has been helpful to you today. I want to encourage you to move into the places of dominion that God has prepared for your life. It is His intent for us. It is His will for us. God has designed you to rule and reign as a king in this life. So let's begin to do it in Jesus' name. Think in a different way and watch and see what God will bring forth in your life. Amen. Open doors today. Opportunities are coming your way. And when the opportunity knocks, when you knock on that door of opportunity, work will be the person that opens the door. So get ready for some work. Get ready for some responsibility. It is the design of God. God bless you so much. Thanks for being with me today. I appreciate it. I love you. I'm grateful for you. Have a great day today. Be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. God bless you.
Everything that I keep missing.